It's a great honor and unique privilege to be invited to chair this unique occasion. And I thank the acting president for finding time to be here in person. And one thing is clear, whatever the political disagreements, it is the unparalleled determination of this administration to succeed in the fight against corruption, including the determination to retrieve from abroad and at home the huge mind-boggling monies which were stolen from our country's commonwealth. And we have to commend that. And that is why it is imperative to give our support to the government while insisting on a permanent end to impunity and zero tolerance for official corruption in Nigeria. Now, I wish to make, in the interest of time, just about 6 main points, essentially the headlines, because I have a paper which can be circulated. First, is that increased success in meeting the challenges facing Nigeria, or indeed any nation, and lasting change cannot be achieved by one person alone, whatever his antecedents and whatever his discommitment may be. In Nigeria's case, we have our president, President Buhari, who, like the Caesar's wife, is above suspicion. But in the typical spirit of our people, it's like leave everything to Buhari. This kind of abrogation of collective responsibility has to stop. Because we have to ask the question, where are Buhari's flag bearers in the fight against corruption in all the 36 states of the Federation, or local government, or in the private sector? Where are they? Are members of the elites in Nigeria part of the solution or part of the problem? I think in the acting president in his recent inauguration of SDG's Private Sector Advisory Group said that the elites are part of the problem. But we also have to make them part of the solution. I recall when my tenure as permanent representative of Nigeria was coming to an end at the United Nations, very long tenure, unlikely to be, it's an unusual time, unless sleep to be, record to be broken. I told my son, who was 13, that never mind this title of permanent representative. Actually, we are not permanent, and my tenure is ending, and I want to go back to Nigeria. He said, no, no, no. And I said, you better get ready to go. He said, no, 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 he's not going to Nigeria. I said, why not? He said, well, Nigeria has not entered the technological age yet. And he can't go back to a country that has not entered the technological age yet. So I told him, I said, well, you are the people to come and help us enter this technology. He said, no, 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 those of you who ruin the country should fix it first. And then invite me to come back to Nigeria. So those who have ruined or are ruining Nigeria must also not only be held to account, but they must be part of the solution. I also want to draw attention to the fact that we don't have a sustained national conversation in reducing the high and growing cost of governance at the federal, state, and local level, which already contribute to this endemic corruption. So I'm arguing that the sustainability of the fight against corruption in the context of an agenda for change must involve a collective national endeavor to open a new chapter in our national life that will represent both a clean break with the past and the opening of a new gateway to the future. So the nation's elite must be part of the solution and not remain the largest part of the problem. And we must not leave everything to Buhari. That's an abrogation of responsibility on the part of all of us. Second, the institutions of governance, including especially the judiciary. I used to hear that justice delayed is justice denied, but it's like justice delayed is the norm. Well, we have a new Chief Justice of the Federation, and to whom a lot is given, from him a lot will be expected as the head of the judiciary. Professor Issa Sagi and I go back many years. We often speak the same language, but in different ways. I have grown much older, but he still remains young at heart. So I'm suggesting we have to have strong institutions to go along with strong leadership in the fight against corruption. Third, in the fight against corruption in Nigeria, we must complement the approach of arrest and punishment of corrupt officials with a revamped national reward system. There are many Nigerians, including public officials, who are decent and honest. But then, do we have a sustained, decent system of rewards? It's not enough to just arrest, prosecute, and jail people, but we also need the development of role models, especially for our youths. Fourth, the pursuit of the contemporary agenda of fight against corruption, in that pursuit, close attention will need to be paid to the measures and steps that will need to be taken to overcome grinding poverty and want among Nigerians. So it's not as if we can choose between fighting corruption and making life better for the majority of our people. The two must go hand in hand. Otherwise, the enemy of the fight against corruption will use the state of the economy or the poverty in the land to justify walking away from that fight. So it's not a choice, but both. Fifth, this dialogue should address the issue of our values, norms, and customs as a nation, and examine factors that promote sustainable hunger for wealth and corruption. Isisage has already mentioned some of that. But also, let's be frank, how can we be celebrating people who have been found guilty and sentenced for corruption? And we belong to the same nation? Is something wrong with us? If we cannot do what we need to do ourselves, and somebody else outside does it by jailing a corrupt official, that is not a source of celebration. It should be a source of embarrassment for all of us. Because the message should be that the resources of Nigeria belong to all Nigerians. And we must all be united to preserve our resources for the present and future generation. It was an American president, Harry Truman, who put it very nicely, and I quote, "We have a responsibility not only to our compatriots, but also to future generations. A responsibility to preserve resources that belong to them as well as to us, and without which none of us can survive." Sixth and finally, the efforts to locate and repatriate stolen monies require aggressive push as well as collaboration with foreign countries. The scale of fraudulent transfer of our resources abroad have been identified in a report of the African Union High-Level Panel on Illicit Financial Flows, headed by Thabo Mbeki. And it shows that what Africa has been losing annually through illicit transfer of finances are more than what the continent receives in development aid from abroad, or even foreign direct investment combined. Moreover, according to another report by the Global Financial Integrity, GFI, a Washington-based research and advocacy organization, reveals that Africa lost about $854 billion in illicit financial outflows from 1970 to 2008. And of this, Nigeria tops all the countries in Africa. We're close to $90 billion. Let me not preempt the resolution and communicate that will be coming from this dialogue. Needless to say that with the caliber of people that have been assembled here and the quality of discussions that is emphasized, I feel sure that we're going to have very frank deliberations with actionable and viable recommendations for our policymakers and the population at large, the result of which will contribute to moving Nigeria forward to a new level of accomplishment and pride in the Committee of Nations. I'm always fond of recalling an incident, true story, in January 1984, when the then General Buhari, head of the military government, received the then Secretary General of the UN, Perez de Cuellar of Peru. And President General Buhari asked him, "We're a new administration, please, you have a lot of experience, you're a global citizen, what do you advise us to do?" And the man said, "Do you want a frank answer or a diplomatic answer?" And General Buhari said, "Of course, a frank answer." He said, "Well, I'm from a developing country, Peru, and people used to say of Peru that Peru is a potentially rich and powerful country, but they have been saying that for the last 200 years. Let it not be said of Nigeria that it is a giant of Africa, potentially rich and powerful. Let them not continue to say that for the next 200 years. Translate your potentials into reality, tangible reality, so that your people will benefit from the conversion of your potential to reality. I think in the end, that's what we need to do. Finally, let me once again thank His Excellency Acting President and the Chairman of the Presidential Advisory Committee Against Corruption, Professor Sagi, and his colleagues. We're also welcoming all participants to this hugely important national dialogue. Very timely, more than timely, overdue. I wish us all fruitful deliberations. Thank you for your patience.